let's jump into talking about ESS and just writing the feature web now. Guys, if you don't know me, I'm Blaine, Kasten. I ran as a meetup, which is fun and challenging. It's great. I just accepted a job total, so I started this week. And it's been overwhelming and fun, and I'm kind of like, feel like the dumbest guy in the room. No, guys, that's you, okay. Second dumbest guy. Unless somebody wants to think about that, and then I'll keep going.
I'll jump in. Third dumbest guy.
Yeah. So the tag was on ESS, NetBridge and JavaScript, all the different features that are in it, learning about it, and also how to start using it today, even though there's not fully browser support yet. So like any good future lesson, go back to the history first. I don't know if you guys know the history of JavaScript in general. I just learned it from this presentation, and I feel like it's pretty helpful to know. It's kind of weird and cool. So basically, it all started back Netscape days. You guys used the word. I was like 6 when I had that. So Netscape 2.0 came out. It was just like a typical browser that rendered this like static HTML. And Netscape wanted to make it a little bit more interactive and fun. So in 1996, Brendan Pike, if I say his name, he created JavaScript. But the big rumor created in 10 days. Actually, I learned that like designed the idea of it in 10 days and then spent a lot more time building it. So he created JavaScript, and Netscape was just about to support it. JavaScript 1. It wasn't called JavaScript, it was called Mocha because Oracle had a patent on the name JavaScript. So he created it, it was called Mocha. Netscape started using it, made the thing a little flashy. And of course, Microsoft, the competitor, decided, like, we want this. Let's create a similar copy of it. Call it JavaScript, and at this time, like, they didn't really know much about the language besides just messing around with the message. So they just wrote their own code with similar APIs and stuff called JavaScript, and that's what happened. I don't even know what browser they provided. And so when this happened, Netscape was like, all right, we just created a language that's like fragmented and like not cohesive across things. They decided to submit it to a company called ECMA International, which they basically just do standardization work for different things. So they're like big main things. So ECMA International took the JavaScript that Brendan Pike made, wrote a publication for it, and it's called ECMA 262. It's the same publication that keeps getting revamped for each version. And so if you ever hear the term ECMAScript, that's like the original version of JavaScript. And so at the same time, TC39 was created, and that's basically a group of people that are like core contributors and like figures of like the language and how it should progress and change. The language players. So that's history. Here's a little history of the progression of JavaScript as it burdens. So the first one came out in June 1997 by First edition, really basic language. There was a second one a year later, and it was to do with some other international standards. I really don't even know what that means, but nothing is in the website. The third version came out in December 1999, and it added things like regular expressions, string handling, controlled statements like if else. If else was in there. I think it was like while.
Probably too wild, whatever it was.
Try catch, there was no try catch before this, so like tons of things. Like I couldn't imagine writing a language without like regular expressions or like error changing or any sort of like you never be able to do things. So I guess it was pretty great. It fits a lot of things. This is like IE8 runs ECMAScript 3. So like currently it's our oldest like running version of JavaScript. I'm gonna say JavaScript for now. So when you have to deal with like IE8 weird things, some of those are changes because you know reading one. So yeah, that's three. Number four was abandoned because essentially like they had this huge list of things they wanted to do. And then none of the group could agree on things, and it was so
long time. They're like, we're getting too far ahead of ourselves. Let's drop this and do like a simpler mode or a simpler draft and like keep adding on features. Let's not do it all at once. So 4 was abandoned. I don't really know when, but at some point in 1999, 2009. And then ECMAScript 5 came out, and that's where our typical JavaScript experience lies in. All of the things that you like now today are in this. So they've added script mode if you guys use that. It helps you, gives you the power of script your evaluation of your code to, make, to help you avoid errors. What else do they do? They add new features like getters and setters if you guys use those. You might not have support IE8, you can't do it. The JSON library is an ECMAScript 5 thing. JavaScript 5 thing. Reflection, if you guys know what that is, that's like the object.hasm property set function, like you're able to reflect into the object and see what it has. So there are things like that, more awesome things. So that's what we got today. Now, oh wait, so 5.1 is another one of those like stupid standard Blaine things. Yeah, I don't really know if I'm going to add anything exciting. So, ECMAScript 6, or if they announced it, ES2015 is the word. You know why? What? You know why? Yeah, they want to release a new version every year. So, that's crazy and awesome. Pretty cool that happens. I mean, if you look at the like, release history, it's like 1999 to 2009 to 2011 to 2015. We'll see what happens every year. So, 6th edition, is really cool. We have a bunch of things that we're going to talk about tonight. We'll go into more details about them. Essentially, you get like classes and modules, things you've seen other languages, different iterators and for loops, generators, a bunch of things. We'll go into details about them. And then there's also the 7th version is in progress, and it basically continues the thoughts in 6, picking up where 4 dropped off, and has a bunch of things that we want to add. One of them I know is like you can mark a function async and then turn it into an async function rather than like everything like using promises or callbacks or something like that. So that's pretty cool. Async function allowing. Yeah, kind of like tuples and stuff like that. And 7. So it'll be really cool. I'm sure we'll hear a lot about it in the coming months, especially if it comes out next year. Maybe we'll design that later. So here's some like here's the TC39 numbers that are currently exist. I don't put this up because like these are the people who decide what code we write basically. They're probably the people who like follow on Twitter, something like that. But how would it be like I recognize and maybe you guys recognize? So Brendan Ike is still on board, Justin Creator, Budacats, probably a lot of people recognize him, created jQuery, he's one of the jQuery members, one of the Rails. Ruby on Rails, some core members. He's in a lot of community. Rick Waldron is also a jQuery contributor. And Alex Wilson, which is a sweet dude that I know of, that worked at Google. You guys remember I presented on the service worker? He kind of made the effort for the service worker. So. Yeah, I read lots of presentations recently that explain the cool thing about TC39 right now is that like prior to recently, the only people on that were like truly like language developers, but now like with you got people that create like libraries as a living, like doing cats and their wallets. So people who actually in the language every day are investing in the future of language. That's pretty cool. So let's talk about ES6 and ES2015. I didn't write this earlier videos yet, so I didn't know ES2015. Over 20 new features, super exciting. So we'll go through them. Disclaimer, I'm not at all like an authoritative information on this. Like, a lot of this is pulled from like blogs that explained a bunch of it. I've used a lot of features, but not all of them. So if you have questions, I'll do my best to answer them. I would encourage you guys just to like try things out. I'll have a link later on that you can go to and like basically try all the language features and see what it compiles down through.
What's your front-end environment? Who's supporting
ES6? So, a lot of people are already supporting parts of ES6. So like Spark or Atlas had their like big announcement, and like the only cool thing is the Mari update where we're going to be a VS6 support for like classes and modules and construction and string interpolation, cool things. Firefox is supporting quite a bit for quite a while, and Google is supporting quite a bit of it, and more if you download Google engineering. So it's ramping up pretty fast. But part of this, after we get put into the media, I'll explain how you can write this today safely working on browsers. So let's go through things. So to do all the features, and we're going to go through each one. The top important list, this is all I really found. That's what I found last day. So. What's up, Rico? So Unicode. I don't really know what this means or benefits anyone, but there's more Unicode options. I'm guessing that if I didn't use like this Japanese symbol, that wasn't part of like the old Unicode, so you get more options for that. I don't really have much more than that. So you guys want to do that? So we'll move on to that. Mockups. This is probably my favorite thing. So typically in JavaScript, like you're just like getting a bunch of files together, and like there wasn't a really good way to communicate from like one file to another unless you dump things in the global space and like everything was public. And it wasn't very like everyone knows that it's hard to architect a big JavaScript application. You can do it any way you want. It kind of moves this module idea. Where you create like snippets of code that can be used in other places, and it makes things easier, right? I just built an entire website in like a month and a half with PS6, and because of like being able to like make small bits of code that were easily testable, it was insanely easy to build some stuff. So here's the syntax. If any of you guys use CommonJS, where you get like the var x equals require or something, this is essentially like if they took from CommonJS and someone from RequiredJS and built this system. So, cool thing to get. That's up from PCs. So, take this file. Essentially, it's exporting some math thing. So, you can import this file and get both a function called sum and a variable function called I. It's exporting a function, it's exporting a variable. Pretty simple. Over here in app.js, you import star as map from the map. So would map would be the file location of the function for this file on the left. Star means everything that's exported, and map is like your variable for what this would be. So now inside of here, map has both sum and pi. And it's like you do this little map.sum, map pi, 2 pi. Yep. So that's a simple use case of import and export. You also get some bottom with a couple other examples of exporting. So export default means like basically if you do import the star as, you need to import map from lib map, you're importing the default. And then you can also export star from other libraries. So if you create a library that basically extends another library just by like exporting all of this plus whatever else I want. It's really nice to build on top of the next set of architecture, simple and awesome. Models is sweet, it'll make very good awesome. Okay, so max set, weak map, weak set. Any of you guys, computer science people, probably know more about this than I do. Essentially, my understanding is they're object caches with like more efficient data structuring. So when you get like the weak version of things, they're essentially, as I explained, it doesn't hold on to memory if the original thing is like a little bit. If you guys know how like garbage collection works in JavaScript, basically like create a variable, if it's not being used by anything else after like the REPL finishes, it'll open up the garbage collection. If on the website, we add all these things to our set. We add all of our things to our set, and they're held in memory by that set. For that variable until that variable is done. With the weak set, you add something that's not referenced, so like I have the data 42. If that was held onto by another variable, like variable object equals data 42, WS add object, then it's going to hold on to that because it's already held on in another place, but here it's not. So it's a pretty net structured. So I feel like if you're not advanced computer science dude, you probably won't use them. I probably won't use them until I get smarter. But yeah, sets of maps, they're very similar to different APIs and stuff. If anyone knows more about that, you can speak up.
Yeah. So does this mean that we preferences have been added?
I believe so. Well, at least in like certain cases. Like weak sets and weak maps. I don't know other cases. But this has been a case of that. So yeah.
What was the weak references were added to JavaScript?
So weak reference being like if something's not moving on to it, it's an application.
What would be an example of a weak reference?
Alright,
moving on. No, I think it's a pointer that the system's not aware of. Like, a weak pointer is on the JavaScript that resides, so I think that idea is you have a weak pointer, and the system doesn't do that. It'll go out
okay. Yeah.
I think it's a bunch of
work. You
got
any computer science,
Steve? Did you go to
college for it?
No. Yeah, unfortunately. That's a long time ago, though. I don't know if I can go back to that. Because the
system's still like, it's right now. I would say close to an average of that. In a way, I would go to school for it, but I would know like, these smarter things. But at the same time, I'm glad I never went to Java. Or other things.
I'm going to go to Java.
Okay. Alright, we'll move on from that. So proxies are a really cool thing that you have a million use cases for. Essentially, you get this ability to like look into something else, take over stuff without being able to like use somebody else's code that you don't get right, you don't really have the ability to like, change the code. You can inject a proxy into it, so you can do things with it and have things. So a simple example is like, so I create this target, it's an object, it's a plain object, and then a handler. Like, so the handler is going to be my proxy essentially. I override the get function, so it's a getter. So there's a bunch of like things that proxies can grab onto. So you can override the getter, the setter, has the property apply, the function, the constructors. Like you can basically like get in your way into other things really easily. That could probably be a dangerous thing, but I feel like you can do really good things. So an example here is I'm creating a getter for my objects keys, overriding it, and basically doing this like printing out hello and the name of the key. So you create the handler, you create a proxy from the target of the handler, and then when I do key.world, world would be a key on the object. My getter overrides that world key and says it's going to return hello name, so it equals hello name. Like, it's pretty insane. It's kind of hard to like think about positive and beneficial, but I don't know. I feel like it'd be awesome. I don't know if you're programming React and you want to like dive into to get information out of a part, you can do that for this, or you can probably inject yourself into other things. Another example would be proxy function. So functions have like an apply method on them. So in my handler, I can override that apply function and like I can take it over entirely. I think you can call the receiver, whatever the receiver is there. The receiver would do the actual original thing. So I'm taking it over and saying I'm a proxy. So when I call my target function, when I call my target function, I actually get the proxy's response. It's pretty crazy. I really want to see somebody do like the same thing. You know, you can do the same thing, but I can't really. I haven't used it. I haven't thought about it.
No, it's a new language. So you could use it for multi-patching, I feel like. But it seems like there could be a good use of like extending things. So say your BigQuery, you create like just general iterating functions. Like you create the also
could you have an interface for existing objects or do you only override functions and properties of existing objects?
Only override. So like you don't get access to everything, you get access to like meta, like runtime level meta operations. So only like the things that already exist there, and you can enumerate
be a good way to send you hooks, essentially on getters and setters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Decorator is just an object that like acts like it's some other object and then will override the methods. Like, so you might use it like if you have a model, you might have a decorator for that model in the context of the view, where you might have some extra formatting when you call a particular method on it or a function. So that way, like, instead of just returning the phone number in raw digits, you might format it out with dashes.
Primitive object, primitive string,
add extra things to it, and like now you have this new special use case for this thing. So like a typical, you would refer to array because it's in JavaScript now, but say you wanted to create a new 32 array to look for there, you extend your array, add all the like functionality for that, and now you can have to create new and new 32 arrays and use that. I think it's pretty cool. Like every single part that I've worked on, I needed like special string functions that don't exist, like string to handleize, or like snake string, or like titleize, like things like that. And everyone always says like don't override like string functions, or don't add to like primitives, don't add functions to primitives. But I had to, because it was like easy to do. So it's pretty cool that now you could like create your own like transformable string function or primitive that has all the same and then it's safe and correct and the right way to do things. Promises, these aren't really like these are from the ES5 or ES6 that have been implemented for quite a long time. You guys have probably seen them. It's essentially like an asynchronous way of doing things. Essentially a promise, like promises that will give you a value at some point. Wait for it by making a then function. So when then is called, it's giving you the value that it's been waiting for. And there's also a catch, so that way, the cool thing about promises is you can cascade thens that like do more things, and any of them fail, you can catch them. So like, you can create a bunch of code that like, I've always really needed like complexities, and if anything fails, you have this one like line of code that catches all of it. That's a cool thing about it. There are also cool things that handle if this is like first then returns a promise. This first then returns a promise, then like the next then can like act on that promise. It's a really cool thing. There's a talk down and about promises that are in detail. Check it out if you're interested. Promises are definitely rising, especially on the server side. There's a bunch of new primitive APIs. I don't know if this is complete, I don't know if it's on the website. But it's quite a lot of new primitive APIs. There's like a new isNAND function, which I think is actually like it works correctly.
Yeah,
I'm like, yeah. So that's super cool. it's here, so like it'll, I think that works perfect too. That's my hope. Just do this. Epsilon, I don't know what that means right now. There's also some good things. String functions, like includes, you can see a string, include another string, or parcel string, you have a string of three things. Any of you guys know, like, interacting with a DOM and, like, never return to the real array, or return to, like, a DOM array of some sort, a DOM array?
Right, DOM block there.
Yeah. So you can do array.com of those things that creates a real array that you're only using. Cool things, array of, you know, passing some things, and they'll create an array of those sorts of things. Yeah, like primitive array things, or like fill. So, like, this takes like what you want to fill with, and I'm not doing this, I have to start on. 077, you can do find, like searching, find on index. Like a bunch of cool things that should help out. But I'm pretty excited for array.value. Array.values, pretty excited for that one because I always want to get like iteration of this those. Cool things.
Do those last three, those iterators, do those receive a callback function?
No, so those return iterators. It's a new thing.
Oh,
so, and we'll get to that.
Okay.
Which is why it's like, so an array by itself can iterate on values.
But if you get an array that I get into, that I don't really understand. I believe with that array.from, you can actually just put in like array.from 100 and it'll generate a 100 blank array.
I think it's the same.
I don't remember if there was a little extra stuff I did around it, but it's a way you can actually generate it from just an unknown set of items, say, that we're going to want to pump into it at some point.
Okay, cool.
I think, or if it
It doesn't, like one, two, three, four, five, and I don't remember which one it was.
Yeah.
But whichever way I did it, it worked and it was awesome. So,
Let's make it easier. My name is Octo Literals. I don't really care about this. I don't think I'll ever use it. If you guys are smart enough to use this, it's awesome. Basically, like, there's already like X literals in JavaScript. You use zero X stuff and like the X literal. Now they have binary Octo, which is represented by the B and the O. So zero B, zero literal, zero O, literal.
Function, like the whole
random things and stuff right here. We're just taking more character space, simpler to treat this way. Another thing about it is it has an implicit return. So like right here, it's b plus 1 is implicitly return to the function. It's nice in these situations where like your math goes something needs to return and iterating. It's just really shorthand, but this would be 3 lines longer if you didn't have to run. So there's different ways you can do it. There's different syntax. This is like the variable that comes in, or the argument that comes into it. It has optional brackets around it, so you can or can't, or can or don't have to.
Is it optional with 2 parameters?
It's optional always.
I thought it required it more than one. It's optional on this.
You might be right.
But what if you don't have any parameters?
If it's multi-line, I'm pretty sure it's not implicitly returned. There's like this is weird things with it, so you have to be careful. And in some cases, you need to put like the parentheses around it.
Brackets.
So I say that the only good use case for it is either like these one-line things on like maps or any sort of one-line simple things like that, where you just want short, readable stuff, or if you're doing like an implicit passing. I think those are the only two purposes for it. I would be pissed if I saw like, a big long function that was written with arrow functions. It would be pointless. So yeah, it's shorthand. It's cool. It's a nicer syntax. Here's our class syntax. Basically, the biggest thing to take away from this is it's just a wrapper around current object prototyping. Like, don't think that this means like real object-oriented classes. It's literally the shorthand for creating a variable, call like skin mesh, setting the proto to the three-dot-mesh prototype, setting functions on it. It's no different than that. It's just sort of shorthand. And it makes it easier to write and normal to read. So you can create like a class, you have it extend another thing, get a constructor, you don't get past the super, which is a bit harder to do currently. So it feels very object-oriented. Also, you don't have to put commas after your closing brackets, which some people don't like, but it makes sense.
So by passing in multiple arguments in a super, that's letting you look into and use methods of geometry and materials in this case?
So if I understand your question correctly, like if I create a skin mesh, first thing that happens is when I create new and I pass it to two arguments, which is geometry and materials, it first calls the three-dot-mesh constructor with those arguments, does all whatever it's supposed to do and initialize, and then you get more things.
You have to call super, though, don't you?
No.
But you don't?
No, you don't have to.
Okay. I suppose that makes sense.
You're setting something more than likely you might want to call super on the constructor, just so you get like all of the expected things.
In the constructor is what I
mean. You don't have to, but
yeah.
That makes sense.
But so super like mixes everything together?
Basically just calls what 3D mesh does originally by itself. And so it's truly part of extending it. Like, I don't think that you would see an extension of something without calling super. So that makes sense. Super just calls the extensions constructor. The parent. If 3.mesh implemented a bone count and you wanted to override it, you wouldn't call super. But if you wanted to override any other things, you wouldn't call super and do your normal object oriented class type things. So it's just fancy syntax. So like these are like getters and setters, shorthand syntax. I don't really know what static means. I haven't seen that before. What is class name? Computers and setters where it's like, so like here, this is like getter from bone count. It's not actually a function, it's just a key on this thing. So I can do like my skin mesh variable dot bone count, not call it and return this bone, something like just the normal thing that getters do.
Yeah, that's syntax. Makes sense? It's kind of nice. I've used it a lot for writing React.js code. So enhanced object literals. Kind of talking to Cole, what Cole was asking earlier about computed property names. There's no reason why this couldn't be a symbol right here. I guess it's not, I don't have a handle of symbol. But computer property names are pretty cool. Basically, like, you could dynamically create a property on an object and assign it. There's also, so the enhanced object literal syntax is essentially the idea that, like, you don't have to do, if you have a key that's like key and then you're assigning to a variable of key, you don't have to do key colon key, you just do key. And it implicitly says key colon key. So that makes a handler right here. It's saying object.handler equals a variable handler that's in the scope somewhere. This toString is basically saying object.toString equals this function called toString. Does that make sense?
Love it.
Okay. I'm out of time. Okay. Let's get moving. String interpolation, normal thing that JavaScript's going to do. Basically, you can like use backticks, which is kind of gross. Put backticks in it, now string interpolation. And dollar brackets, you can put a variable inside of it, it interpolates all to like one normal string. So it's a hello Bob, how are you today? Easy thing, I remember the best.
They're also called templates.
What?
They're called templates as well.
Yeah, I hate that.
And you can multi-line them without any special characters between lines.
Yeah.
Except any indentation white space you put in there shows up.
I like that.
You like something.
So if you have like line one is completely outbounded and you hit enter and you tab it in four spaces and you use spaces as your characters, you're gonna get hello name comma space 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 how are you. So it's actually gonna put those in as like real characters in your string.
Cool.
Is that
strictly to the space character you say?
Well, yeah, it takes any white space, any white space landing characters.
It's like a preformat thing.
Yeah.
Alright. Structuring is freaking awesome. I love it. Essentially, it creates a nice syntax. You like it?
No, I'm going to try to slide dedicated to it.
Yeah. Nice.
I didn't know that.
Close your head. We have it fast. I didn't know as much time as taking. So, this structuring, it creates a nice syntax for getting values out of an object or an array at like certain places. So, if you look at this thing, this is kind of a ridiculous way to use it. But yeah, it makes it work and really nice. So essentially, every single one of these, gosh dang, screens, all the screens, every single one of these like things in here are going to become a variable in your scope, and they're going to become a variable matching to what is in that place of what's returned from here. So get AST node, it's going to return an object of with keys of OP, the key of LHS, which is another object, the key of OP, and the key of RHS. Does that make sense? So it returns that object, and this basically mirrors the syntax of it. And so then, at that point, you don't have to assign getAstNode to a variable, and then create another variable of like that thing dot op, that thing dot LHS dot op. Like it creates a really easy way to get into an object and get what you want out of it safely. So even if getAstNode didn't return these values, it would still create it safely. But they'd be undefined. So you don't have to worry about like the object not matching up correctly for breaking the runtime. And then you also get that on arrays, like, so here, this is kind of gross. But like A and B would equal 1 and 3. It's getting index of 0 and index of 2. Skipping this one. Yeah, that's kind of weird. So fail soft structuring, it's kind of what I'm talking about, how it's like if it doesn't match up correctly, it's not going to fail. It's going to be undefined. So it's trying to get an empty value in there. Defaults, we'll get into that in a second, but essentially, I think this is dope. You could have A equal 1 if it doesn't get anything. So it's not going to match anything here, it's going to be undefined, it's going to default to 1. So pretty crazy, you can default a response from something unless it gives you something better. A couple of uses of destructuring. In a function, you can take like a name, so it's expecting you to pass an object, or fail silently, it doesn't. And then it will get the value of x, or the value of name, and put it in here. So if you pass it in 5, it's going to just come to log 5. I think this is really cool. So you could also just grab like
the different parameters there and do something. So like set states are really cool thing I do in React. And if I only want to grab certain things out of it and put it in there really simply, I can do that here. So like here I'm calling it down here with other things, but I need to like pull up what I want to pass it along. Restructuring is awesome. Makes it really short and simple. And frankly, like I think this is way easier to read than if I like set object var name equals object.name, var value equals object.value, this dot save, another object of name, name, value, value, like it saves a ton of code. And it's more readable. So default to rest and spread is kind of what we've been looking at for a while. You can now default arguments to functions. So like over here, x and y. We're expecting if y isn't passed, it's going to equal 12. That's pretty awesome. Every other language can do it. Now we can do it. So rest. If you guys haven't heard of rest, that's spread. No, that's rest. Okay. So rest is basically saying like additional arguments to pass this thing. So rather than doing like getting like your arguments and creating an array from it and like grabbing index of 0 and figuring out what else is there, which would be equivalent to x and y here. So x is going to be your first variable, and everything else is going to be an array, multiplied. So here's the way to like work out what's left over. Yeah, sorry. Guys, if you need to use the restroom, it's down this hallway to the right before you go across the hallway.
Sure.
Should have said that before. And then spread is essentially taking like an array of things and casting it out. So like, if I didn't have any dots here, this would only receive one argument, which would be x, and it would be an array. But since we're doing this dot operator, it casts them into like each individual thing. So it's pretty easy to pass the ends in. So that way you wouldn't have to do like array index 0, array index 1, array index 2. Pretty cool. Really cool things, make things shorter. Let const. Two new variable declaration mechanisms. Their main purpose is like keeping the scope to your scope, keeping the variable to your scope. So in this, so let is primarily for, it's only a variable in the scope. If you use var, it kind of bleeds outside of the scope, meaning like if you do an if statement and you create variables in your if statement, those variables are also available outside the if statement. But if you use let inside the if statement, you can't access those outside the if statement. Const is a constant, so you can't change it once it's defined. It's not perfect, because if you create an object that's a constant, you can still mess with it. So like, you just can't change it from being an object. You just play around with it. There's weird things to it. Yeah. Any questions about let or constant? Alright, this is where I get confused and don't really have an answer for you guys. So there's a symbol.iterator, which is apparently a function. So we're creating a dynamic property on this Fibonacci object. It's a function that's an iterator, and this is what it returns, the next function, which the next is like the ability to call the next part of the iterator. It's a generator. It's not a generator. The generator will be like, oh, generator's next, and it's next.
Yeah, well, they call generators what they should be calling. It's amazing. In the other
line. Oh, yeah. Okay. So, but we got kilometer is because that's what the spec says. I frankly can't help you with this very much. It kind of confuses the crap out of me. Because I haven't used it yet.
It's lazily generating the entire Fibonacci sequence.
Yes. we're running out of time. I would say let's dive into it. Generators are basically like the demand generator is like JavaScript you've always been able to count on. Once you like run code, you can count on the fact that it's going to run until it completes. Generators allow you the ability to like have things stop calling themselves until something else asks it to call. So a generator is like, yeah, so like exactly that. So when you call a generator, instead of executing down the line, it goes until it hits a yield and then it stops. And the next time you call it, it's going to go to the next yield until it stops. So if you look at these calls down here, basically I call generator instance.next, it returns that first yield value 1, it's not done, so it returns an object, which is kind of interesting, it tells you when it's done. Do it again, it returns value 2, which is yield 2, value 3, yield 3, and then the last time it doesn't return value, it just says it's done. So
it's kind of interesting. You can like do a little bit of that. There's an entire Node.js framework built around generators. That looks pretty cool.
Koa.
Koa is what it's called.
Yeah.
So there's good use cases for it. I just don't understand pretty much yet.
So that star in the function name says this is a generator?
Yes.
You can put that before or after the space as well.
Yeah. So that, that really is a generator. My bad. Yeah. That can use a lazy sequence. Aha! So JavaScript did it right, I guess. don't we all just love this, like, step-headed child? Step-headed child. Red-headed step-child. Alright, I'm getting a little bit down. So Reflect API, there's a lot more added to the Reflect API that isn't quite understood, but now it's announced, I'm sure we'll get more information. One of them being the being able to inspect into symbols and things with other reflections, more on the meta level, like the runtime meta level, being able to get into things. And Matt and Jim is like, remember that there's a list of proxy things that you can inspect into? I'm guessing into them, like, you can reflect into all those things too. Real quick, we're in ES6 now, so all these cool things coming out. Browsers only support portions of it so far. IE8 sure as hell doesn't support any of it. Or 9 or 10. Maybe 10. So how do you write it now and still build a website? Essentially, this is your source. Babel.js. It's a transpiler, essentially. But its purpose, and there's been several transpilers created on the idea of writing a piece of code now. Babel.js is really leading the front. Really phenomenal job there, even like working on like ES7 stuff and being able to write that. But you always have to be careful with that because it's not finalized, so like you might write code that needs to change later. But essentially, Babel.js is really cool. It's really simple to use because they basically integrated with every single. Is this what I was looking for? They basically integrated with every single type of thing like Gulp, Grunt, Webpack, Mozzarify, like pretty much every single thing you can use Babel with to transpile back to ES5 or ES3 code. Or depending on what feature of ES6 you're writing can be transpiled back, some features can't be transpiled back to ES3. So if you're developing for IE8, do your due diligence, figure out if like you can use class methods and if they transpile correctly back to ES3. Classes do. Yes, Babel's really cool. It also has a really cool try it out thing. So you can write code, and this is essentially what it's going to compile down to that can run on every sort of language. So here I'm setting up generators, and this is what happens when you do generators, what it compiles down to.
Oh.
So yeah. Really, yeah. So really, writing the stuff right now is all about Babel. Like, it's amazing. She needs to do that. Yeah, so shortly we'll be able to get online. You can see it. That's the feature web now. You guys have any questions?
Yes.
Yeah.
How do you track what is supported and what's not?
So Babel's website has stuff on it.
There's actually guys got a whole chart for browser support.
For browser support that already exists?
Yeah, KANGAX on GitHub. Okay, he's got compatibility tables.
Get a bio.
Yeah, sorry. Just Google him, sorry. It's not even remotely draw.
So this question wasn't quite so much
the second link that was there.
So, was your question about what can currently run in modern browsers or like
just keep track of what you can use on which platform?
It's not what you go back.
No, yeah, go back. To Google the setting link.
You should have a compatibility table right at the top. This bio. What was that? The same.
Yeah.
Cool.
There you go. We're going to get the HTML.
That's pretty fancy.
And it turns out that IE8 has the third highest support behind Firefox, latest and whatnot.
Great. Yeah, so there you go. There's three things I wanted to explain it. Any other questions?
Would Can I Use be another good resource for checking on a lot of those things, or
would what?
Can I Use?
Yes, actually. Can I Use.com. You guys know Can I Use? it's like the place up here that can do things. So like class import. So HTML imports. That's not it either.
Generator.
Isn't this more focused on HTML CSS?
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, you're
probably apparently it's the same guy.
Yeah. I guess a chance. Okay. Any other questions?
Just an observation.
Yeah.
Matt just told me that if they introduce any more stuff, I won't have anything to talk about. But I used to have this list of the 9 things that make list a list.
Okay.
And JavaScript now has all but 2 of them.
That's good.
That's good.
Awesome. Yeah. Sweet. All right. Yeah, that's it. Let's give us like a few minutes to get Joe set up. Sorry for running long on this. But yeah. Give me a minute.